When I say the word accountability, what's the first thing that comes to your mind?
Somebody else looking at me and saying, okay, you're not doing something right.
Instead of doing a discipleship, we've replaced that with accountability.
I think of more doing things together and keeping each other accountable, like through more like camaraderie.
To me, it seems like a negative thing because it is someone coming up to you, correcting you in some way, and you going, you're right.
Yeah.
I'm wrong. I looked up accountability on my Audible because I wanted to listen to some books on accountability. I looked on it online. Everything that comes up is business related, which is ironic because it doesn't seem like there's any accountability in business anymore. At the heart of it, you have to be willing to be accountable.
I'm Chuck Tate, and here at Fellowship of Believers, we encourage families, strengthen marriages, and edify the body of Christ.
I'm Larry Grimm. We also promote biblical doctrine in a fun and engaging way.
And I'm Sarah. And if it's Christian, we're talking about it.
This is the Mike Charleston Show. All right. What's up, guys?
Hey.
Thank you for watching. If you're watching on YouTube, thank you for listening. If you're listening on the podcast, thank you for joining us, Larry and Chuck and Sarah. I've joined us. I always tell Joshua to get that cheer ready, but he never has it ready. And so, yeah, I forget.
Wait, I think we need to welcome Chuck back.
Chuck is back.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Yep. Back from vacation, yeah. Or as we like to say, suspension.
That's right.
And which, by the way, Chuck, remind me, I met a relative of yours this week.
Oh?
With the same last name, at least.
Okay.
And he said we're all related. And he gave me a little history of you guys. So anyway.
Oh, well, he had my last name and knew my history?
Yeah.
Or he just knew the history of the name?
Yes, he knew the history of the name.
Well, that might be a good enlightening thing for me.
Yeah.
You might have to share that.
Yes. So this week, we got an interesting show for you today, people. We are going to be talking about accountability. And this one, we went back and forth on, and we may not agree. We may have different takes on it. So buckle up. And so let me ask you guys right off the bat here, Chuck and Larry and Sarah even. Yeah, I was told not to interrupt Sarah, so I'm going to work on that. What do you think of when I say the word accountability, what's the first thing that comes to your mind?
To me, it's the first thing that comes to my mind is somebody else looking at me and saying, okay, you're not doing something right.
Okay. Yes.
Or, you know, me doing the same thing, just trying to keep, you know, if we think of children, you know, are the children doing what they're supposed to be doing, or are they in line? That's kind of the
what you think of
the thought. Yeah.
What about you, Larry?
Yeah, kind of. All right.
Same thing. You can't say that.
Well,
you can't do that.
I mean,
this is a podcast. You can't just say ditto.
Okay, I have mixed emotions about
it.
Mixed feelings.
Wow.
I feel like I don't.
But well, the first thing that you think of when it just
Larry,
I think of
what are you doing?
Modern Christianity that's trying to replace something of a deeper meaning.
Oh, okay, interesting. That's very eccentric there. You know, very more esoteric.
More of a, instead of doing a discipleship or more of a training type.
Okay.
We've replaced that with accountability.
Okay, so when I, and I'll get to Sarah's in just a second here, but I looked up accountability on my Audible because I wanted to listen to some books on accountability. I looked on it online. Everything that comes up is business related.
Yeah.
It's always business related. And I'm like, well, that's interesting because we need accountability in business, which is ironic because it doesn't seem like there's any accountability in business anymore. But that is what comes up when I do a search. But I'm very similar to you guys when I think of accountability. Sarah, on the other hand, not so much.
Well, you didn't really talk about what you think of.
Oh, well, when I think of accountability is kind of like, are you doing what you're supposed to be doing and people checking up on you to make sure that you are, we're going to get into a lot more of this, but basically that's kind of the basic thing, your accountability partner. I think of that. I think of just making sure that you're on the straight and narrow. You know, that's kind of what I initially think of. And you obviously had a different kind of take, right?
I did.
When you first think of accountability, what just comes to your mind?
I mean, the first thing that comes to my mind would be accountability partner.
Okay, that's the first thing that comes to your mind.
Yeah,
okay.
But I feel like I see accountability as a much more positive thing. It's a much happier thing in my mind. Just I think of more doing things together and keeping each other accountable, like through more like camaraderie.
A group effort.
Yeah.
But so Larry and Chuck and I were a little bit more negative.
Yeah, I would say.
And Sarah's is a little bit more positive. So that's fine, though, because I don't think that's necessarily right or wrong in those ways. There's definitely different ways that we can look at accountability. And like I was talking with Sarah last night or a couple nights ago, and it's not that she's not. It's not she's wrong. It's just I don't think most people are thinking accountability like that. Right. I think more people are thinking it more like us.
Yeah.
That it's I gotta go see the principal. I gotta give an account for what I just did. You know, I got suspension coming up here or detention or something like that. Or in sports, if we weren't doing what we're supposed to, go take a lap, you know, go do a lap. We're holding us accountable to show up on time, to do our, you know, get down on the ball. You missed the ball, so go do a lap. And, or worse yet, because Mike didn't show up on time, the whole team's got to run now. Yeah, like, yikes. Right. Yeah, that's not good.
Yeah, we were talking about military a little bit before the show.
Right.
That was a definite thing in the military. You know, you worked together as a group.
Right.
And if one person acted up, then everybody was held accountable.
Everyone got disciplined.
Yes.
Yeah. So I guess that's another word that comes to mind is discipline.
Yeah, and I would guess that from Sarah's perspective, you know, I think of it, I'm like you, accountability, I kind of have a negative connotation. But from her ideas, it sounds like more like of an encouragement.
Right. Yeah. So that's how you look at it.
I do.
She's just so cheery. She's just so happy.
Okay, so I just think of accountability as something that God put in place because he made us a body. And so we're all supposed to work together. And so you look at all the verses, like, you know, like we talk about all the one another's and preferring one another, exhorting one another, admonishing one another, provoking one another to love and good works. And to me, that's all a form of accountability, but it's all good. It's like when we get together as a church, as believers, those are the things that we're supposed to be doing. And I feel like encouraging people to do that is kind of a way of
Well, being accountable. That's my view was more negative, but when I was reading about this, I came across an article talking about that very thing that basically is the church, we should all be accountable to each other in the church.
Yeah. Was it written by Sarah?
No.
Oh, okay.
But rather than, because my idea is, like you said, accountability partner, where you have one person, you meet once a week or whatever, and you give your dirty laundry and they say, well, you need to do better, whatever.
Yeah, do better, Larry.
Yeah, it's like, well, it's no different than going to a Catholic priest and...
Right. Or a psychologist.
Yeah, or a psychologist.
Yeah, I mean, honestly.
But if you're coming together as a body in a church, which we should hold each other accountable and lift each other up, whatever. So, it's funny you mentioned that, Sarah.
We mentioned accountability partners. You want to go ahead and talk about the definition first?
Of accountability / accountable, which we were looking up the definition, and it seems like it came into existence in 1753 or 57. What did I say?
Really?
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah.
Does it have to do with, because you mentioned business.
Right.
And what I found is it usually is regarding business and the word account comes
right.
from.
Account, right, yeah. To give an account
yeah.
And you reconcile your books and you give an account for this. But so then it just makes sense that in your life, you've got to give an answer. Synonyms were like answerable. You got to give an answer.
Answerable, explainable, or accountability is like taking responsibility.
Taking responsibility. Right. So that's the definition, is taking responsibility for one's actions, answerable or explainable. So give an explain yourself, you know, basically. What did you say, Chuck? He said this, you know, you got to explain yourself.
What did you mean?
Yeah, right. And so we're holding you accountable for what you said. And you're like, yeah, I probably shouldn't have said that. You're right. You know, and so that's why we always think of it as maybe a negative thing, even though in the long run, it's a positive that if I change. But to me, it seems like a negative thing because it is someone coming up to you, correcting you in some way, and you going, you're right.
Yeah.
I'm wrong. And I apologize. It seems like there's some kind of repentance involved in accountability, right? That's what at least our view.
Right, exactly. Or you feel like you have to do some penance or
something. Yes, something. You feel bad about something. But so anyway, that's kind of the definition. Yeah.
So we mentioned accountability partner a few times. So what does that look like? Have y'all ever had an accountability partner?
Yes.
Yeah.
So have you ever had an accountability partner? Oh, you did?
Yeah.
How did that go?
That's probably why I have a negative view of it.
Maybe what it is.
So go ahead. You had accountability partner?
Yeah, but it was basically, if I felt like I was always on the hot seat and not doing good enough.
Right.
Okay. Was it helpful to have an accountability partner?
No.
Okay.
Nah, yeah. I didn't think it was helpful for me either for having a partner per se.
Yeah. I didn't either.
Right. Okay. So accountability partner, let's just explain what it is in case people are like, well, what is the account? I've never heard of this. But it is a thing that the church has kind of made up or something like that. But it's where we get together and say, okay, it could be a group of men maybe or a group of people, women even, you know, whatever. But let's say me and Chuck, we're going to be accountability partners. And so we meet together maybe once a week, maybe once every other week, maybe twice a week. I don't know. And we get together and we just open up and say, hey, how are you doing?
Yeah, you're not doing so good.
Okay. You know, are you praying? Are you reading your Bible? Are you loving your wife? You been studying anything? How's your thought life? Yeah. You know, all those type of questions. You can, there's probably, if you go online, they probably have questions.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure there are.
And
there's books.
There's, oh my goodness, I can imagine. But that's the basis, that's the basic idea of accountability partner. Did you have one growing up? Ever? No. You never had one?
No.
And maybe that's why you think it's so cheery of it.
I mean, I knew about them and I heard about them in church, but I guess I never had one.
Didn't need one?
Well, having an accountability partner, I don't think I ever had a accountability partner. I'm trying to think, like, was one assigned to me? Like, I had people in my life that kept me accountable, and I'm very grateful for that. There was some experiences in my life, and I'm glad that they called me on things that I needed to watch out for or pay attention or correct or repent even. Right. And so I'm glad that they would call me out on those things. So I am grateful for that. But I don't think I ever sat down with someone. We did have like Bible, every once a week we'd have Bible breakfast for the kids in our high school. And so like we started it. So I was in high school and we just got together and talked, but I don't think we like went through the 20 questions and, you know, just kind of hung out.
Did you find your accountability partner was just as bad off as you, or
his is different?
Well, yeah. So I was, you know, I sought mine out. I was dealing with some issues and said, "Hey, will you help me?" And at that time, it was a pastor.
Yeah, it didn't reciprocate very well.
Can he really open up? Right?
Yeah, exactly. You know,
we were pretty decent friends, but. Yeah. Yeah, it didn't seem to go. Actually, there was so the Mike, maybe you two, that there was another pastor that I was close to, and we actually were prayer partners.
Oh yeah, yeah,
and it wasn't really accountable, but that was really beneficial. That was really good. Mm-hmm. You know, we get together once a week and pray. We'd talk for a couple minutes before, but we'd pray for a good while, and that actually was more encouraging or building up.
Well, that would be something Sarah probably would be called accountability partner, right?
Right. Well, I would think it seems like if you label these things, it kind of raises expectations of what it's supposed to be. But when it's something that's kind of organic, natural, it works. But we kind of label it kind of and make it kind of contrived to try to force it to work.
Sure.
And it usually doesn't.
Kind of like this podcast.
Yeah.
We got to force it to work.
I wouldn't say that.
No.
So do you think that that's something that we shouldn't do is have on a regular basis, like people that come to church or something to ask, like, are you reading your Bible? Are you praying? Are you?
Yeah. So here's okay. So we have questions, you know, should we ask questions like, have you been reading your Bible? How's your marriage? I used to have a guy. Well, okay, so we did have a guy keep me accountable, but he was keeping the whole church accountable. He was an elder of our church, and there was probably five men and four or five men, and he would call once a week usually and kind of check up and just, have you been reading your Bible? Have you been praying with your wife? Have you been studying the scriptures? How's your marriage? How's your kids? You know, he would ask those basic questions. Now, like I told you yesterday, I do appreciate that. I mean, it gets me at least thinking about that direction. Right. You know, I lied half the time, so it didn't matter. No, I'm just kidding. But I didn't mind it, and maybe part of the reason I didn't mind it was because I didn't really have a lot of issues in those areas. Mm-hmm. It was like, okay, yeah, I'm reading my Bible, I'm praying, yes, I'm loving my wife, I'm loving my kids, you know, all these things. Those weren't issues necessarily in my life, so I wasn't offended by them, and I didn't have to worry about it. But I do think a lot of these questions take away from relationships. Right. I feel like it's not terrible to have these questions if, you know, it's better than nothing, I guess. But I feel like in a relationship-style church, by the communication you have with someone, it was like to me with that guy that would ask me those questions, I appreciated those questions. But the next hour that we talked, I would think that you would know if I had based on our conversation, you know, like, hey, man, this is what I've been studying. This is what I've been doing. This is what my kids are, you know, we're talking, we're getting to know each other. And then just spending time with each other, you get a sense of, ooh, he's struggling a little bit. He's having a rougher time. Are you all right, Chuck? Is everything going all right? Right.
Yeah.
You don't have to confess now.
Well, that's what I mean by it's more organic rather than scripted or contrived. So
it feels more like in a scenario like that, if it's another man or a man to man, another man doing it, it feels more like mentor than being held accountable.
Well, especially in your case where it was the pastor.
That
was a little.
Maybe I should have chose somebody else. No, I'm just kidding.
Well, I mean, honestly, in that structure, the pastor, he's not going to reciprocate very well. You know, he's not going to open up if there were some struggles to, no offense, Chuck, but he's not going to do that to you, most likely.
No.
You know, but he's probably there as a mentor.
I don't think it was, at the time, I don't think it was expected.
Right.
Which a one-way street probably feels more like confession, you know? It's not the same.
So it's more like a mentorship probably. Yeah. And so you're probably right. But no, in a perfect situation, I think though, as we are growing together and we get to know each other, I get a sense of where you guys are.
Right.
You know, it doesn't mean that I can't ask those tough questions and be like, you know, Larry, I've been noticing, so are you all right? You know, are you, you been reading your Bible? You know, it just seems like, you know, things have been slipping a little bit. You know, can I call you on that? But just to, out of the blue, just give my checklist out of the way. That seems cold. Yeah. It seems non-relational and just like, this is what we have to do. But that might be better than nothing. You know, like if you're just going to a church and you can hide and disappear and no one calls you on anything, no one cares about your life, at least that checklist, someone cares enough to call you, right?
Or they appear to care anyway.
Yes, right. I'm doing my duty, you're doing your duty. Come on, let's get this. And it does open the door that if, because accountability at the heart of it, you have to be willing to be accountable.
Yeah.
Like I can lie.
Yeah.
But the questions might open up that door to where I'm tired of hiding. You know, and you're just going through the motions, like, here's the questions. And I'm like, you know what, guys? I'm really struggling.
Yeah.
I've been lying to you guys. I need help. So it may open those doors eventually to where your conscience is so pricked that I think the point of that is to get to that point where I can't sleep at night. I'm not looking at Larry when I say that. But you know, it's like, this has been bugging me and you guys talk to me about this every week. And you know what? I got to say something and I'm not doing well. I'm not, you know, so in those circles, maybe that is fine for that type of group that you're in. If you're in a really good relational church, and I like to think that we have a very good relational church, that we would be able to tell. My problem is when to actually step up and say something. I don't like that. I'm not afraid of confrontation when it comes to theology or things like that. But when it comes to personal life, I shy away. I don't want to push and say, how's your marriage? It doesn't look like your marriage is doing good. Because I feel like I'm going on a limb, and what if I'm wrong?
Right. Well, so, I would say, like, I mean, this past year we had some struggles, and I didn't hide it, you know, but I was, you know, you guys were here. I could express those things.
So you were willing to open up, though.
Yeah.
I think that's a big difference, though.
Right.
For that to work, you have to be willing to open up.
Right. Yeah. And it's got to work both ways.
And that's what we were saying, that without, it seems like the negative, without the discipline, there's no bite to accountability. What's the point? Yeah. And that's when Sarah piped up and was like, what are you talking about? I think accountability is wonderful, and give your take on it.
Well, because I think that there are two sides. Obviously, there is the part of holding people accountable when you see people in sin, when you see people struggling, when you suspect people are struggling. Right. Like, there's a time to speak the truth in love and to ask the questions and to approach people and say, hey, you know, I think maybe there's some issues here. But, you know, I just, to me, I see accountability more on the positive side, where I think about, you know, just in life, I feel like there are things that we do that we're accountable for. Like, you know, I did the C25K with the kids, and I'd always choose a kid, you know, one or two of them would run with me. And if I run by myself, I'm not going to run as hard. I'm not going to run as fast. I'm not going to, you know, I'm just going to give up earlier. I'm going to make all sorts of excuses why I can quit. But when you're running with someone, you really can't do that very easily, because, like, well, I'm not going to quit when
you're the group
with
mentality
somebody.
Really helps.
Right.
So, I mean, that or exercising or, you know, whatever. Even I look at the Bible bee, and, you know, everybody knows we should memorize scripture, but very few people do it at all. And it's like when you sign up for the Bible bee, even summer study, it's like you're going to memorize things, and there's the group thing, and, you know, you're talking to other people and like, oh, did you learn this one yet? And you're learning together. And so I feel like that helps a whole lot. And it's, but it, the thing is, it's something you already want to do.
Yeah,
so if
absolutely.
You don't want to do it, it's not going to work very well. But it's like, I want to memorize scripture. And so this is a way to help me, even with the Bible challenge that we've done, you know, and you log in, you can see, okay, other people are reading, you see their progress. And it's not a shame thing where it's like,
no,
you know, why aren't you reading? I
but
see
you
you're not
as... But you don't want to be shamed at
well,
the same
you don't
time.
Want to be shamed, but it's really like, I want to do it. But when I just do it on my own, I don't get as far.
And that is true. When you do things on your own, you can do it. There's no doubt if you're really determined. But I remember playing baseball in high school, and we would do our stretches. And after our stretches, the seniors would just take off running. And we had to run for 15 minutes through the school, up and down stairs and all that. And they ran at a pretty good clip. And we had to go follow. And we can't lag behind. And so in that way, that was keeping us accountable. And like, we got to move. We got to keep up. You know, because if the coach just said, Mike, go run, I'm not going to be that motivated. Right. I'm going to start just jogging. But those guys kept a pace, and we had to keep up. And if you fell back, it was kind of a shame, but you didn't want to be kicked off the team. You didn't want to be removed.
So it was something you wanted to
do. Yes. So, and it was, actually, it's funner to go through the same struggles together, you know, and be like, yes, we accomplished that. And then, but if it was just everybody go run, do your own thing, it's just not as good. So I get what you're saying there. Yeah. It really does help to have someone, hey, you want to work out? Let's work out together.
Right.
It's probably better to have a workout buddy.
Yeah.
But even though you work out alone, usually.
Yeah, I do.
But would it be easier if you had someone to work out with?
In some ways, yeah. I guess maybe for now, because I've been doing it for so long by myself, it'd be weird.
Right.
But, or different, I should say. Not weird.
Yeah, that's right, different.
I get in trouble for saying weird.
I mean, maybe it's because I like to do things with people.
Yeah.
Maybe,
well, and that's like true. You know, I was going to say, like, for me, you know, this past year, it was easier for me to express the struggles I was having because of the relationship we have.
Sure.
Whereas if we were in, like, a big church, like a mega church or something where... We're nobody, it would be easy for me just to withdraw and not
keep it in.
Yes. Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And then if somebody said, well, you know, we be an accountability partner, if somebody I don't know, I'd be like, eh, whatever.
Yeah. You think I'm going to open up to you?
Right. Exactly. I don't know you, and you don't care about me.
Michael Thornton, he was always saying that he went to this one group, and it's like the first question was like, everybody was like, okay, so how many of you are looking at pornography? And he was like, who in their right mind is going to confess to complete strangers?
Exactly. Yeah.
And he's like, this is a total waste of time. Like, can we start out with something that we can build trust in this room? And I'm like, yeah, exactly. That's where the cold, harsh of the questions, just like, there's no relationship.
Right.
There's no nuance to it at all. It's just harsh. Did you? Yes. No. Okay. Well, you shouldn't. You really shouldn't anymore.
Yeah.
You need some prayer for that. I got some suggestions for you, but it's like, well, I would rather hear that from someone who cares.
Exactly.
Yeah, right. Well, that's why in regular churches, institutional churches, or whatever, accountability is pretty much non-existent because you don't have a relationship. So, I mean, if you don't have a relationship, you're really not going to have real
accountability. So, here's a scenario. In a mega church, they probably have these care groups or small groups or whatever you want to call them, life groups. And in those, there's probably some sort of accountability, maybe, but yeah. like to what degree? So say there's a couple in there that are struggling and they get divorced and there's a split amongst the group. Should that person gotten divorced with this person? They kind of take sides maybe. And then what happens, that group is like, well, she shouldn't have left him or he shouldn't have left her. And how are we going to hold them accountable? What's the church going to do? You're in your small group. So that's where I'm like, there's no power behind it. And that's at the heart of it. It has to be reciprocated. You have to be willing to open up.
Right.
You have to be willing to want to be held accountable for that. Yeah. And I feel like people that are in sin don't want to be held accountable.
Well, they don't. Exactly. They don't. And that's the thing is that even in a small group, and we have a small church, and you know, we like to think that we're pretty open with each other. But even in a group like ours, you can still put your mask on and hide. So, I mean, you have to want to open yourself up and to say, hey, I need help.
Well, that's what I'm saying. The crying a little bit kind of helps a little. I mean, you can sense some things when especially in our type of a group, you know, no one has something to share and they kind of slink away and you see how they're reacting with their spouse and their kids and you want to say something and there's been a number of times I wish I would have said something long before and then eventually they bring it out, but by then it's almost too late. Yeah. And it's never too late, but you know what I mean.
I think Larry said this, that the idea, I mean, the whole idea of accountability has to be built on trust.
Yes.
Yeah. You know, if you don't have a trust relationship with someone else, then
what's the point?
You know, it's not going to work. So, well,
especially in our day and age, we don't have, like, there's not one church. Thousands of churches in Baton Rouge. And if I have a problem with you, Chuck, and you have a problem with me, we just go to different churches.
Yeah. That's right.
Or if we're in a mega church, we just sit on different parts of the church.
Or show up at different times of service. Yeah, different
service. And we don't have to deal with it. And so it feels like it's really hard to do some of the things in Scripture today because of just the number of churches and there's no intimacy anymore. So it's really hard. Doesn't mean we can't try.
Exactly.
We need to try. And within the groups that we're in, we still need to try to hold each other accountable. But it doesn't always have to be negative. You know, it can be positive, a positive thing. But that's what we're here for, is to look out for each other.
It should be coming from a desire for it to be positive.
Absolutely. Yeah. Like, what's the goal of it?
Right. You should be willing to have somebody be helped.
Yes, right. It's not for me to gloat over him, right? It's to bring him into repentance, or if repentance is needed, or just comfort if comfort is needed, or whatever, right?
Yeah. So, turn a corner here a little bit. What about church leaders? How are they held accountable?
So, we were comparing this, how the only really people in church that are held accountable are the church leaders, and that is through the structure of the denomination, basically. And so, there's a sense of accountability by if I were a pastor of a Baptist church, maybe, I don't know, maybe Assemblies of God, because I grew up in there. If I start to go off the rails a little bit, the board would get together, and then the district would come in and see if I'm going off a little bit. Now, that doesn't necessarily work in the congregation so much. Right. That's where the accountability partners come in, and that's where the problems are. But the church leaders are held to a certain standard of sometimes. And there's ways around that. Yeah. You know, there's been so many scandals and pastors being involved in some of these things, and they let them off the hook because they need them for another scandal. It's absurd. Well, I'm serious. We live in Baton Rouge. There's a few scandals that have happened. Well, Jimmy Swaggart.
That's a good one.
Yeah, that was a big one.
Shouldn't the leaders be accountable to the people in the congregation?
So in a perfect world, yes, we should be accountable one to another. Just because you're a church leader doesn't mean you cease being accountable to others in the group. It's not like, well, I'm the hierarchy. Well, that's the way it is today, unfortunately.
Touch not the Lord's anointing.
Yes, they're usually pretty untouchable.
Yeah.
Like, you know, they're...
Which is dangerous, very dangerous, and all the other people are the problems. And unfortunately, it shouldn't be that. We should be able to hold each other accountable. In fact, the church leaders should be held more accountable by the group. Like, say they're not the qualifications in 1 Timothy 3, where what if they're not leading, raising, what's the, have their house in order.
Right. Yeah.
You know, that's very open-ended, and I know, yeah, but if maybe the people say, hey, maybe you should just take a step back and just get your stuff in order, right, and then when it's time, you can be a church leader. Yeah. We just got an idea that a church leader is the preacher and the one out in front all the time, and that's not the way it's always supposed to be. But there's a qualification for this position for a reason, and it's really not even a position per se, right, but it's a...
I was going to say, it gets a little more complicated when money gets involved.
Oh, my. Absolutely. Yeah, very much so. So anyway, is that good for church leaders?
Yeah, I think so. Yes, we got it. So I think we've touched on this some already, but how does accountability require humility?
Oh, yeah, it requires humility.
Yeah.
Pretty much, because you're going to open yourself up to, you know, either, say, hey, this is where I messed up.
Right.
It's either humility or humiliation, right?
Well, yeah, that's the thing, right? It's, if it's forced on you, then it's humiliation. If you humble yourself, and I think that's a godly thing, though, if people that care come to you and ask a question, and maybe it is part of those 20 questions, or maybe it's a relational,
right,
hey, man, how you doing? And you open up. That is a humbling thing. You have to humble yourself to say, I don't have it together. You know, I'm missing it here. I'm struggling here. I'm missing the mark here. I've sinned here. That's humbling.
Well, and that's where trust comes in, because you have to trust that they care about you genuinely.
Right.
That it's not just a position they hold, but it's something they actually care about you as a person.
Yeah, so. I've had a time where something happened in my life, and the church I was a part of, to discipline me, they took me off the worship team. And I'm like, what does one have to do with the other? Like, the one over here wasn't as bad to kick me off. I was playing bass guitar. So I'm like, I don't understand. He's like, well, you need to sit under a teaching right now instead of being a teacher. I'm like, for one, I'm playing bass. I'm not teaching, but now I have to sit under. So it becomes a legalistic thing at times, and that's the danger of accountability, where the discipline of that. So say I come and say I'm struggling here for whatever it is. You know, I got an anger problem, and I'm just really struggling. And the answer usually is a bunch of principles and a bunch of check up with me, and until then, you have to be stripped of everything that you are.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, that is not going to encourage people. Now, there are certain things that you need to be stripped of. Like if I'm in church leadership and I'm like, I'm committing adultery, well, then maybe you need to step down. Yeah. You know,
it's
like
time to take a break.
But, you know, people do have issues, and people are going to struggle sometimes with something maybe. And you are like, hey, for me to say, I'm having anger issues or thoughts of lust. And, you know, for me, all of a sudden to be stripped of everything because I was being honest and open is, well, let's work on this for a second.
Yeah, you know? It doesn't encourage honesty, does it?
Right. But I know that you're with me on this and you're willing to work with me and walk beside me on this, then we can pick this up. There is a time where church discipline needs to come in, and that's where we're headed here with 2 Thessalonians 3, 16 through 14. There is a time where we do have to separate to shame, and that's a terrible term these days, and we don't like it because it's almost like bullying or something like that. But why don't you go ahead, and this is an interesting passage. It's fairly lengthy. I don't know if you just want to read the underlined parts of this, but it's Second Thessalonians. Whatever she says.
2 Thessalonians 3:6-14. And it says, now we command you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye withdraw yourselves from every brother that walketh disorderly and not after the tradition which he received of us. And then it goes on to talk about people not working. And then at the end of verse 14, it says, note that man and have no company with him, that he may be ashamed.
Right. So these people were waiting for the coming of the Lord, right? And some of them weren't working, and they were being busybodies, and he was saying, our example and what we did was not that, and you should follow our example in that matter. And they've become distracted, and they're being busybodies and causing problems.
Right.
And so note those people. Now, he does say after that, which is you know, don't treat him as an enemy, treat him as a brother, mm-hmm. but don't have any company with him. And that is tough. That's a tough, you know, there's other parts, 1 Corinthians 5, where it talks about separating yeah. from him, you know, and these are sin issues. These are really big sin issues.
I was going to bring that up in 1 Corinthians where they
right.
cast him out.
Yes, yeah. and those are definitely sin yeah. issues. These, it may not be so much, he's just walking disorderly. And so that's very open-ended, mm-hmm. you yeah. know, like yeah. Chuck went to a baseball game. That's walking disorderly. Chuck went to a baseball game, you know, so that's very open-ended. But I think we got our friend the Wasp back. But it's very, very open-ended. So we have to be careful and we have to remember grace. But there might be a time where as part of this accountability that you are walking disorderly, that I can't go out to eat with you. I can't hang out with you right now because you're being an embarrassment to Christ. And yeah. maybe that would make him ashamed. Maybe not. I don't know. But I don't think you just do that secretly. Like, you have to voice those concerns maybe. And like, this is why I can't hang out with you or yeah. talk to you. He has to figure it out.
Why'd he go away?
Yeah, right. And he has to become Sherlock here to figure out why.
Right. So I think the next scripture here that we have, which is Hebrews 10:23-25, gives us a good example of how we should interact with one another to encourage each other, hold each other accountable.
Yeah. What does it say, babe?
It says, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching.
Yeah. And this was our kind of our theme verse for our camps that we put on. It's on the back of our Shindig Life shirts. And it's, that is our goal, and that is part and parcel of accountability mm-hmm. and encouragement and edification. And yes. there's right. a lot going on in this verse here, but we get together. A lot of it is, hey, I'm trying to encourage you to be who you say you are. You know, at the end of the day, you say you're a Christian. Yeah. But let's make sure that is how you're walking, yeah. and you know inside what you really are.
And then we have one more verse, Proverbs 27:17.
Iron sharpeneth iron, so a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friend.
Yeah, and at the end of the day, this is it, right?
Yep.
That's the point of accountability. Is so, like, kind of like Sarah's more chipper, positive view is like, hey, man, we are here to encourage and to edify and to sharpen each other yeah. by pushing.
Maybe yeah, right. some are pushy, push one another.
Well, I was gonna say some too, are a little pushy.
Well, when you think of iron sharpening iron, it's friction involved. Sometimes yeah. it's not always pleasant,
right? Yeah.
But if you know that there's a mutual respect there and there's a care there,
right.
you can endure that and it absolutely. Makes you better.
Yeah.
So that's
yeah. So Larry, you have some questions that we saved here for the end. Did we already address some of those?
Well, I was thinking, because you mentioned the list, you know, you go through the list of how's your prayer life, how right. are you reading your Bible, all that. But I think part of as iron sharpens iron is as a church, and you think of an institutional church, you don't have this opportunity because it's one man
right.
preaching and everybody sits and listens. You might talk a little bit or whatever, but like in our church, we all have a chance to say something.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have a chance to say when they say that, people are thinking about in the meeting itself,
right.
but this is beyond the meeting
right.
too.
Be, yeah,
this is while we're eating,
yeah.
even after the meeting, sometimes someone will open up a little bit more after right. the meeting yeah. and be like, mm-hmm. I was thinking about this week. I'm like, why didn't you say that during the
yeah.
meeting?
But like some of the questions, should we ask deeper theological questions? Because that would sharpen our knowledge and understanding of the scripture, whereas right. you wouldn't necessarily have a chance. Like we right. were talking, Michael Thornton and I, Sunday before, what he brought up the week before and about heaven and things like that, but it was a little bit deeper
right.
subject, which means you have to know the Bible, or if it's brought up, you can go study it, and then the next week you can bring that back.
Right.
Those are beyond just the shallow, you know, did you read your Bible?
Yes. Or, well, him bringing that, I mean, you kind of know, like I was telling Sarah, I know where he is because when we talk, he's always telling me the things he's reading or studying. He's an open book.
Right.
And so I'm like, I know he's in Isaiah right now, you know? Yeah. So it's not that hard. But like what you were suggesting, babe, was that like the church would get together and would it be difficult to do something together? Like we're doing a Bible study together. We're going through John.
Yeah.
And we get together and we just we go through it and we discuss it, which is nice. It's something we right. do together to encourage to study God's word. But what about like memorizing? Would it be cool to like, hey guys, let's memorize this one verse this week? Can we do that and push that? You know, and as a church, we do that, or for the kids, or you know, something like that, where we do something together that's kind of keeping us accountable, right?
Right.
Quote unquote accountable. Yeah. And that would cover like even Bible doctrines.
Right.
Let's teach some Bible doctrines and discuss those things so we can be kind of on the same page and keep each other accountable on what we believe.
Right, because most churches nowadays, they don't really teach doctrine.
No.
It's a feel good message with some principles or something, but you don't really gain a great understanding or get a good grasp of Bible doctrine. So when you're confronted with that, most of the time, most Christians today get lost and they can't give an answer because they've never been challenged, and they don't, because most of the questions they get are these shallow kind of feel good questions that are kind of easy to answer. But if somebody asks you,
or lie,
or lie. But when you start talking about deeper theological questions, you have to have some kind of knowledge of that.
Sure. Right.
And so it goes a little bit deeper. Yeah, it pushes you. So
yeah, I'm always curious where you guys are, because it helps me go and study some more and be like, oh, well, that's an interesting thing, because maybe I don't really have anything I'm looking at. But then Chuck says, I'm doing a study on faith. I'm like, well, let me help him out. Let me, you know, keep him accountable. You know, we wouldn't say that word, but, hey, let me do some research on faith, and then next time we get together, be like, hey, did you see this passage on this? And you're like, well, actually, I was struggling with that this week. Yeah. You know, what do you think? Or, you know, whatever. Be like, oh, cool. You know, so it can be organic, and sometimes you may need those questions to get started if you just don't know how to, because sometimes we're relationship backward. Yeah. I can't say retarded, you know, but
slow.
Right. We're so backward sometimes in how to do relationships that maybe we need some helps. And there's nothing wrong with that.
Right.
That's true. But I think we need to grow from that and just get to know one another, if that makes sense.
I think it does.
Yeah. Well, I was going to say, I think with a trust thing and the care, some people like myself, it's not easy for me to open up to people.
Larry, you can open up here. No one's listening.
Yeah, I know.
Well, I mean, I do think accountability takes a lot of work, because not only do I have to open up, but I have to care for the people that come, and I have to prefer them, and I have to think not on my own interests and whatever, and think on them and how I can help them, because the point of coming together is to edify.
Right. Yeah. That's the Hebrews verse, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
I gotta consider one another.
And whenever you step into an area where you're trying to help someone, if they do come, then you're actually carrying that burden.
Yeah.
You know, exactly.
That's an extra addition for you that you're actually having to carry along as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
All right, Joshua.
Well, I think you have an announcement. Okay. You want to say something about the camp that you usually forget.
Announcement.
Usually say, we got a camp coming up.
Yeah.
We got a camp coming up. It's filling up. So if you want to come, you can go check it out at MississippiShindig.com. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Okay. We're putting things together. We're getting all that.
It's getting close.
Yes.
It's getting close.
If you want to come see us, go ahead and check out the website, sign up.
Yeah.
And there's only a few spots left. So
going fast.
That's right.
Maybe you could open it. If it fills up, maybe you could open up to an auction.
Yeah, we'll see. Yeah, that'd be nice.
The Mike Charleston Show.
History with Larry.
All right, Larry.
All right.
You got a little, you got some knowledge you're going to drop on us.
Oh, yeah. This is a fun one.
Is it?
Yeah. Not as weird. Well, maybe. It's a little weird, but not as weird as last week.
Okay, do we have to do weird history with Larry?
Well, not, maybe. Yeah.
So what do you got on it for us?
Did you ever have a teddy bear growing up?
Of course I did.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Did you ever pretend that it was real or wish that it was real?
Oh, of course.
Wouldn't it be cool if you had a friend that was a bear? Like a real bear?
So you're talking about a real bear.
A real bear.
I think we did, and we kicked it out of our house.
Like
it was my in-law's dog named Sophie. It was a bear.
It was a bear.
It was basically a bear.
So you're talking about like Christopher Robin had a friend named Pooh Bear, like that?
Something like that, okay.
But if it was real, a real bear.
It was a real bear.
That would be cool.
And this is a story about a real bear.
Like a grizzly bear?
A brown bear.
A brown bear?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's cool.
It was recruited into the Polish army.
What are you doing?
Those Poles.
What?
Yeah.
They recruited a bear?
They did. These are your relatives.
So the Polish army during World War II, of course, Poland was decimated by the Russians and the Germans.
Yes.
So the Russians, when they came in, they kind of annexed Poland for a while, and they took a lot of their army as prisoners of war. Anyway. Yeah. That's right. So they, when they were, the Polish army was annexed back, I guess, for lack of a better term, make it shorter. They were reorganizing, and they found, somehow they found a cub bear in.
While they were reorganizing their government?
The army. Okay. And the government, actually, the Polish government actually was in England for a while, operating out of London as allied.
Yep.
For, anyway, this army unit, they found a cub, and they nursed it. They fed it condensed milk, and
sweetened condensed milk.
It just said condensed milk. Oh, okay. So yeah, they they raised this cub, and it became part of their unit.
There is no way. Yeah, come on, dude. Like, what are we talking about?
So the soldiers treated it as a child.
Oh, my goodness. Did they haze him?
I don't know. But it grew, and it was at one point this unit was being transported by the British, and the British soldiers said, "We don't take mascots, so you can't take your bear." They said, "Well,
this isn't a mascot.
It's not a mascot." They actually issued him
a rifle,
a rank, and
he wasn't carrying around a rifle.
No,
okay.
But so they said he was a private in their unit.
Oh wow!
Wrong. Yes.
Yeah, he was adopted by the 22nd Transport Company's artillery.
And we wonder why Poland doesn't have a very good army here. Okay, just making sure.
Well, so in Egypt, the bear learned.
In Egypt? Yeah, now he's in Egypt?
Yeah, well, this unit was transferred down to Egypt
to train and stuff?
To fight down in the North Africa unit.
Oh, my goodness.
Because of the heat, the bear actually learned how to break into the shower units for the soldiers and cool himself off. He learned how to turn the water on and cool it.
Well, bears are smart, you know?
Yeah, which was a problem because the water was rationed because it's in Egypt in the desert.
Oh, that is a problem then. So he probably doesn't know how to turn it back off.
Right.
Yeah.
He also got an appetite for beer and cigarettes.
Oh, my God. From
the other. Well, what did he do with the cigarettes? He probably didn't know to light them.
No, he would eat them.
Oh, that's disgusting.
Oh, that's horrible.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah, no.
But the others.
Oh, but on a side note, there was a story about a bear recently that broke into a car, and these people were camping, and they had all kinds of sodas and everything, and he drank everything, broke into everything except for two, their diet drinks.
Bears are smart, like you said. One of the things the soldiers taught him was a trick to do to new recruits.
Okay, what did they do?
He would take the new recruits and hold them upside down by their boots.
The bear would?
Yeah, which would kind of freak them out.
Yes.
Oh, my goodness. That's crazy. They never had trouble with, a bear can be a dangerous animal.
Yeah, no, apparently this bear actually became, one of them.
He was in the military. He was disciplined.
Wow. Yeah, it's kind of funny. I mean, could you imagine being a soldier, new soldier, and then this bear comes up?
I would have been like, what are we doing here, boss? Yeah. Like, well, come on. As long as he doesn't outrank me.
Yeah,
that's ridiculous. Right.
There is no way.
Well, the bear actually was seen on the front lines carrying ammunition. And later,
did he know which side to be on? Yeah.
Later, it was revealed that it was spent ammunition, just the shells and stuff. But could you imagine being on the other side and seeing a bear on there, in the opposing army?
No one, of course.
This unit actually loved the bear so much that they actually changed the insignia on their uniform, the patch, to a bear carrying an artillery round.
Were these people from Chicago? Yeah. Yeah, the Cubs and the Bears?
Aww.
Yeah, so at the end of the war, the bear ended up on a farm in Scotland.
Was he farming?
He just lived his life on the farm. Yeah. Just
hanging out at the farm.
Yeah, in Hutton in Berkshire, Scotland.
Oh, Berkshire. Yeah. Berkshire?
Somewhere, yeah, Berkshire, yeah. So however you say it. I don't know. I'm not Scottish.
Whatever. But.
Wow, that is so
funny. He died, Scottish.
He died in 1963.
Oh.
Partly due to damage to his esophagus. Probably to
all the cigarettes.
Lit cigarettes he was eating. They actually, the bear's name, I don't know how to say it, but it's Wojtek, W-O-J-T-E-K, W-O-J-T-E-K.
It's Polish.
Polish, yeah.
Wojciech?
Wojciech.
Wojciech.
Anyway, in Edinburgh in November 2015, they unveiled a bronze statue commemorating this bear. So
wow. That is great. It's kind of, when are we going to see the Disney movie?
I was going to say, it should be made into a movie. I know, no one would believe this is a true story.
This is a true story.
And we would say that's so unrealistic.
Yeah. But yeah. So,
what did he do on the front lines? Like,
they just had him carry stuff that it wasn't actually, like I said, it wasn't live ammunition.
Like, if you're the enemy, but, do you like shoot at him? Like,
I don't know. Could you imagine? I mean, like, they got a bear? What else do they have over there?
The zoo. Like, there's a giraffe coming at us, and a rhino. Is this like Middle Earth or something?
Yeah, I know exactly. Or Narnia.
Right. That is crazy. Wow. So Wojciech, is that where we're going
with? Yeah, Wojciech, I guess.
Wojciech. Wojciech,
yeah.
Wojciech. That's cool. That's interesting. Yeah, I honestly, if I was fighting next to a bear, I'd rather him on my side, I guess.
Exactly, yeah.
But I'm like, dude, pick up a weapon.
I know. I think I would have taught him
how to
shoot.
He's good close range, but I don't know about far range. I don't know. Well, yeah. That's cool.
But yeah, it's kind of funny, isn't it?
Yeah. Wow. That is a strange... No, I've never heard that story. So yeah, thanks.
I got another story about World War II, but I'll save that for another strange story of World War II.
World War II brought out the best of us, huh?
It did. There's some... Yeah. So that'll be probably next week or so.
The Mike Charleston Show.
Music with Sarah.
What song do you like?
All right, babe. What do we have here today? This is the song of the week. And this one, you know, what do you and David have in common?
David from the Bible?
David from the Bible.
Okay. What do we have in common?
That you guys like to praise the Lord.
We do. Yes.
I'm assuming he did, but I know you do.
Yes, I do. And I think he did too. If you read the Psalms, it kind of looks like he did. So.
Yeah. So this one's a fairly new one. It's from Phil Wickham from his
Hymn of Heaven. Yeah, not the newest album. Now he's got another one out.
Oh, okay. So the Hymn of Heaven album. Let me say that twice. Heart Full of Praise.
Heart full of praise, because I guess I, like David, have a heart full of praise. This is a great song, great album, actually. But this song in particular, I think is just beautiful. I have put it on repeat many times and just listened to it again and again. And I love to sing it. I love to hear it. And I just think it's beautiful. It basically is the gospel message all wrapped up in a song, and the response to the gospel, the response to Jesus coming to this earth and living as a man and dying in my place for my sins and setting me free, is that I have a heart full of praise to him for what he's done for me.
Right.
I mean, that's...
It's pretty simple, right?
That's pretty much it. And I mean, the words are beautiful.
The music's fine. Solid. It's not like rocky or anything. It's really low key. And it's a sweet song. It's nice. It's one of the better ones on the album. It's hard to pick a good one, but this one's a pretty good one. What's a few lines that you like in this song?
It's really hard to narrow down. Just check out the whole thing. Yeah. I do love where on the first verse it says, well, it doesn't really have a chorus. It kind of just has a verse. And then at the end of the verse, I guess, is the maybe type chorus. But anyway, but at the end of the first verse, it says, "You gave your life to set me free. Forever I will sing your name, hands high, heart full of praise." And that is my heart.
So this is a Baptist song.
No, probably not. Yeah, it does talk about raising hands. And so, I don't know, I feel like some people maybe have a problem with that or something. I don't know. But if you read in the Bible, I'm like, there's just a number of times, Old Testament and New Testament, where it talks about hands lifted high. And so I feel like, you know, there are some things in the charismatic world that are maybe a little out there, but I don't think raising hands is necessarily one of them.
I don't know how that became a charismatic thing or not, but it's just when you think of, you know, praising, I mean, you... you've been out west, you know, and I've heard people when they, especially at the Grand Canyon or something like on a mountain, and you just stand on the edge and you can see it all. It's very impressive.
Yeah.
And you just like, what do you do to praise a God that has created this, you know? And the least thing we can do is lift our hands, right?
Exactly. I mean, so. I don't know. I feel like with some songs, it's really hard not to. Like, you, I don't know, when I'm singing this at home, like, you just want to lift your hands and praise to God. But anyway, but I don't know. There's just so many good words this song. I love the end where it says, after all is said and done, and after every race is run, I will see my Savior's face. Mm-hmm. And then the hands high, heart full of praise. And, you know, I think it's Philippians where it talks about we run a race. Mm-hmm. But anyway, Timothy. Yeah, that's what I'm thinking of. But anyway, I just think of, you know, crossing that finish line. And my favorite passage in the Bible is Hebrews 12. And it's, you know, where it just talks about how we're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. I picture, you know, we're running a race, we're crossing that finish line, and when we cross that finish line, we'll see his
there
face. And I'm like, that's just, you know, that's what we live for. That's what I live for. And so it's just an incredible moment to think of when I finally am there and I do see him face to face. So. Yep.
No, that's exciting. That's what we desire for. At least I hope that's what we desire for as believers, is our end game is to see him, to be with our Savior for eternity and to praise him in full. I mean, we're limited here on earth.
Very limited.
We're encumbered by physical ailments at times. We're tired. We're weak. You know, we're getting older. But man, can you imagine just being able to praise him with everything, you know, that you have?
And I really, it's hard to imagine that, because I think my favorite thing that I look forward to in heaven is that I'll be able to sing and my voice will never go out. Because here it's like I'll sing, or, you know, we'll be at some event, you know, sing along or something, and we're singing for hours, and eventually I just can't keep singing.
Right, your voice goes out.
Right. But I'm like, when I'm in heaven, well, we really will. It says forever I will sing your name, and it's like I'll be able to sing forever.
That's right.
So
that's right. Yeah. So Hymn of Heaven, Phil Wickham. What's the name of it again?
Heart Full of Praise.
Check it out. We keep saying we're going to put the link in the description. I have to go in after and put it in, but it's a pretty popular song. Just go search Heart Full of Praise by Phil Wickham.
The Mike Charleston Show. Marriage.
All right, babe, we're getting closer to the end of your book here.
Yes, we are.
And so what chapter do we have today?
This chapter is called Philippians.
You know, I was told, I was going through some of the comments on our YouTube channel, and someone was saying that Mike interrupts Sarah too much. And I'm like, that is absolutely true.
Welcome to my world.
Did I just interrupt you? Okay, go ahead. Okay. No, so anyway. So I'm going to try not to interrupt her.
Okay, well, this chapter... this chapter is called Philippians 4:8 for marriage.
And marriage.
I feel like most people maybe should be familiar with Philippians 4:8.
But if not, why don't you go ahead and inform them?
But Philippians 4:8 is the verse that says, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. And so... that verse struck me, some time ago before I wrote this. And
Which is a very good verse, by the way.
It's a great verse.
I think it's one of our daughter's favorite verses.
And I think so. But all of life, it's, you know, very applicable.
Absolutely.
But I just, you know, in thinking about for marriage, I thought, wow, you know, if I as a wife just stuck to thinking on these things, whatsoever things are true and honest and just,
you mean pure. With your spouse?
Yes.
Oh, wow. Imagine
lovely,
that.
You know, because so many times it's like I think about, well, not me, but, you know, I feel like it's easy to think about the things that aren't lovely.
About me?
No. Oh. But I feel like, you know, we should be thinking on whatever things are lovely, whatever
like
things
are. Like the
cafe
we went to?
It was lovely.
Oh, it was lovely.
Maybe not to you, but I thought it was a cute little place.
Anyway, stop interrupting.
But if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. So we're supposed to think on the good things of our husbands, of our wives too, for husbands. Sure. But, and I feel like if we started to do that, and I think a lot of people would be like, well, that's hard to do. And I'm like, well, but that's what the Bible tells us to do.
Right.
Is that we're supposed to direct our thoughts. So when your thoughts are going somewhere else, we need to say, no, okay, no, let me think about what is good, what is pure, what is lovely, what things are, you know, full of virtue in my husband that I can think about and be like, oh, well, you know what? He is really good at this. And he is, I'm really thankful that he does this or he does this.
I can
this.
Open a jar really well.
That's right. You can open a jar.
Yes.
So anyway, I just feel like, you know, if you just, you know, it's one verse, easy to memorize. And if you put that to heart and then you apply that to what you do in your marriage with your spouse, even with your kids, I mean, really, like we said, in all of life, if you choose to think on those things, I'm like, it's going to change your perspective a whole lot.
Yeah. The one tricky thing about marriage is that you have two people that come together. And the tricky thing is that you rub each other the wrong way every once in a while, probably more than at job site. Well, I don't know about job site. I mean, you got workers, but you can stay away from your workers. You know, your kids will rub you the wrong way, but it starts out at home, then branches out to your neighbors, and then branches out to the community at large, and then to the nations, you know, and so on and so forth. Well, he tells us to love our neighbors, and the closest neighbor we have is our spouse.
Yeah.
And so if we can't do these things at home and with our spouse, how are we going to start with our neighbors and the community at large? So this is why it's very important. You know, you look at that verse, Philippians 4:8, and you say, well, it's just so hard. Well, the rest of life is hard. You know, you think loving your neighbor is always easy. So start practicing. Yes, it could be difficult because you have a very personal relationship with your spouse and you've had history and there's, you know, arguments that are not finished quite yet, you know, from years ago, and you're still reliving some of these things, and there's bitterness that maybe has crept in. Well, once again, like you said, the scripture is there still telling us what to do. It doesn't always say it's easy.
It doesn't.
It just tells us to do this.
Right.
You know, these are the things we think about. We can direct our thoughts. And this verse specifically is really good for all of life, but specifically in marriage. It seems like we forget verses for marriage. It's always for the outside, but not for marriage. And if you really apply these verses to your marriage, it would be amazing how it transforms it.
Yeah, for sure. Well, I mean, and the Bible says that they'll know we're Christians by our love. And I mean, I think your kids will know that you're Christians by the love that you have for your spouse.
Absolutely.
You know, it's right there front and center for them to see, like, okay, that's real love when, you know, people aren't always treated maybe the way that they should be or whatever. So I'm like, that's a great opportunity to display it. And, you know, the devil likes to take little tiny things and blow them up to be big. So one little flaw in your spouse and like he'll take it, make it seem like it's just such a big thing. And it's like, no, we need to have the right perspective. And I heard somebody say once that you should write down, I don't know if it was 20 or 40 or some number of things.
Let's go 40.
Okay, 40. 40 things that you love about your husband.
Okay, 20.
Okay. Anyway, you write down all these things that you love about your husband. So on a day where maybe he's frustrating you or you just aren't seeing eye to eye, you go get that paper out and you're like, all right, wait a minute.
Okay, 10.
You go get that paper out and you remind yourself, okay, you know, yes, I'm frustrated about this, but
you can find the good.
There always are good things. So
right. I know you might be frustrated and there is difficulties, but if you look hard enough, even in some of your friends, that you do that with your friends.
Yeah.
But even with parent-child relationships, there's always something good. There is no one out there is just pure evil. I mean, it's just like, really?
Yeah.
You don't have something that you can say, well, you know, there's really something good about him here.
Hey, this is Joshua Charleston, the producer of The Mike Charleston Show. Thank you for listening to the show. If you want to follow us, we're on Facebook at Mike Charleston Show and Instagram at _ Mike Charleston Show. Please support us on Patreon for exclusive content. This episode is over, but if you want more, check out the website at fellowshipofbelievers.org for more information. The Mike Charleston Show has been brought to you by Fellowship of Believers.